I'm going to ask that you would open in your Bibles to the Gospel of St. John, the 7th chapter, as we continue to go through the book of John. We are about a third of the way through. There's 21 chapters, and this is, we'll finish chapter 7 today. In John chapter 7, verse 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his heart or belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spoke he of the Spirit, whom they that believed on him should receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified." We want to talk to you on the subject today, what flows out of your heart? What flows out of your heart? Father, we come to you today and we thank you for the Gospel of John that makes things so simple for us to understand what it means to believe and what it means to have salvation. And so, Lord, we ask that as we get into your word today that you would speak to all of our hearts, Lord, from the pulpit all the way down to the back pew. Father, just minister to our hearts today. And Lord, we thank you again for your word, and we invite the congregation to come and dine. The master's calling, come and dine. You can feast at Jesus' table anytime. He who fed the multitudes and turned the water into wine, come and dine. The master's calling, come and dine. Feed us, Lord, at your table. For us in Christ's name we pray. Amen. We're going to begin by identifying our apologetic issue, and then we'll move into the message today. One of the reasons that I do this is because many of God's people don't know how to stand up and give a defense for some basic things. And so we've been dealing with just very briefly, very lightly, touching on apologetic issues. And so the apologetic issue that we want to just state today, and it's this: atheists say there is no God, all right? Atheists say there is no God, right? So if there's no God, why do they spend their time fighting something that does not exist? That would be like a doctor coming up for a cure for a disease that does not exist. So again, you know, if atheists believe there's no God, I mean, it's just like, if there's nothing right here, then why should I spend my time fighting nothing? I just keep on going because there's nothing there. So that'll help somebody out next time you deal with an atheist. In John chapter 7, we see that Jesus is celebrating the Feast of Tabernacles. And it says this on several occasions. If you look at verse 2 of John chapter 7, it says that now the feast, the Jews' Feast of Tabernacle was at hand. In verse 10, it said, "But when his brethren were gone up, then he also went up to the feast." And so Jesus was at the Feast of Tabernacles. And, you know, what is the Feast of Tabernacles? I mean, that's what I want to know is, you know, what is it? If this is where Jesus is at, because he's going to make a powerful statement a little bit later here at the Feast of Tabernacles. And so what is it? Well, the Feast of, some people call it the Feast of Booths or the Feast of Tabernacles. The Hebrew word is Sukkot. And it's a commemoration of when Israel, you know, we remember when God took the Israelites out of Egypt and they had to wander through the wilderness. Well, they just didn't sleep out under the sun. you know, and or under the moon, but they built booths or they built tents to sleep in at night. And so this actually commemorates their journey through the wilderness, where they slept in these booths and God took care of them. And so this is a celebration to look back to the time that God blessed them, that he watched over them in the wilderness, that he took care of them, and they just wanted to celebrate and thank God for his care and protection. So that's why Jesus actually was in Jerusalem at this time. Now, as we continue on, we see that some of you may even see it today, that there is the Feast of Tabernacles or Sukkot, especially, I think it just happened a couple of weeks ago, if you were in Squirrel Hill. Or maybe there are other people who live in other suburbs of the city that are Jewish. Well, what is one of the things that they do? Is that many people, they actually build a booth in their yard for 1 week. So again, if you were to drive through Squirrel Hill, where we have a great Jewish population, that you would see these booths in their yard. And so why are these booths out there in their yard? Well, again, it's commemorating how God took care of the Jewish people when they were in the wilderness. And so it lasts for a week, and at least one time they have a meal out in the booth. And then some people even spend one night in the booth. So, you know, again, traditions that come out of the Bible that have lasted to today, and we can see these things current in our society. And so Jesus actually went there to celebrate the Feast of Booths. Now, an interesting thing that happened is that sometime during the feast, the priest would go to the Pool of Siloam and would take, and this was a very significant event, and everybody that came to the feast understood how significant this event was. And so he would take a picture and he would fill it with water from the Pool of Siloam, and then he would take it back to the temple and he would pour it into a basin at the foot of the altar, which was a very significant thing for the Jewish people coming to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. So isn't it interesting? Isn't it interesting that Jesus stands up in the temple? The Bible says on the last day of the feast, when everybody's focus and everybody's attention would be in celebrating the Feast of Booths, when everybody's attention would be on the priest pouring that water into the basin at the altar, that Jesus takes that opportunity to stand up and say, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. And he that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow living waters. So Jesus makes this great announcement at the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, as we look at John chapter 7, just real quick, we see in verses 10 through 13 that the Jews remembered that he had turned the bread and the fish and multiplied it, and so many people came to seek him when they heard that he was there. And so Jesus takes this opportunity in John 7 to preach two sermons. The first sermon he preaches about doctrine, and he says that, you know, my doctrine is not of myself, but it is of my Father. And then the second thing he does is that he straightens out the law of Moses, circumcision, and Sabbath. So he spends time addressing that. But we see that there were some that sought to kill him because he claimed himself to be God. So there were many that tried at this occasion to take him and kill him, but as Jesus had already said, is that his time was not at hand. And then the last thing that Jesus does is that he prophesies about the Holy Spirit. He prophesies about the coming of the Holy Spirit. And he says in John 7:37, in the last day, the day of the great feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. People are thirsty. People are thirsting for something. You know, we see in our society today that people are chasing all type of things. They're chasing the bottle. They're chasing drugs. They're chasing relationships. They're chasing fame. They're chasing success. They are thirsty for something. And Jesus says that if anybody thirst, let him come unto me. And you know, I think about when I was playing football in high school and in college. You know, we had these things. They were big plastic things, and they were filled with water. And you had these little hoses coming out, and you could, you know, they had a handle on them. You could squirt and drink the water. But the thing is, you know, and this is crazy, right? That when I played football, they wouldn't let you have, you know, just go get water. You know, if you go get water, they, hey, Glaze, get away from that water. You know, because you had to wait till you had a water break, right? And so, and today, man, you know, what do they tell these guys? Yeah, you know, they say stay hydrated, right? You know, they're telling them, drink water, drink as much water as you can. So I guess that was abuse, you know, that we could, you know, we could actually report them for abuse, not letting us have a drink. But I remember that when we did get a water break and everybody just ran over there and how, you know, you just had that parched tongue, that dry mouth, that cotton mouth. And you went over there, and you just stood over there. And now there's guys waiting behind you, right? Because they want to get a drink, too. And they're like, hurry up, man, hurry up. Why? Because they were thirsty, and that water met their thirst. And you know what? And people today are thirsty, and they don't even know they're thirsty. And that's the sad thing, is that they're trying to quench their thirst in all other places except coming to Jesus. You know, and I hear people joke all the time, man, you need Jesus. You know, and they say it facetiously, and they say it like a joke. Man, you need Jesus, you know. And you know, it breaks my heart when I hear people say that, because the fact of the matter is that you are thirsting for something, and Jesus is the only one that can quench your thirst. And he stands up, and he announces that. And then we move to John 7:38. And he says, he who believes in me, as the scripture have said, out of his heart. I like what the old King James says. It says, out of his belly will flow rivers of living water. When you drink from the living water, out of your belly or your heart will flow living water. And you know, the problem is that we have to turn to Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 13. And let me tell you the problem. Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 13. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the living fountain of the fountain of living waters, and have hewn out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. And so I would ask the question this morning. Let me explain to you that God says, I offer you living water. If you could put that picture back up there again. God says, I offer you, look at that. Look at those waterfalls that they're flowing. I don't know if you've ever been by a waterfall. Man, it's just a beautiful, breathtaking sight. God says, this is the waters that I offer you. Man, pristine, fresh, clear, living waters. But there were these things called cisterns. And cistern was like a big clay pot that they stored water in. And what would happen, sometimes these cisterns would break, and then mold and fungus and all type of defilement would come into that cistern. And God says that rather than drinking from the living waters, that my people wanted to drink from these filthy cisterns that have all type of bacteria and disease in it. And if you drink from a cistern with bacteria and disease, out of your belly will flow polluted waters. And I just see a lot of people today that out of their belly is not flowing the living, fresh, clean water of God. But what's flowing out of their belly is filth and defilement and evil and wickedness. And God forbid that be the testimony of his people, that we would drink from the living water and that out of our bellies would flow a clean and a pure life. And so Jesus says in the next verse that this all was in reference, and I love this picture right here, and I know you can't see the words, but I just love this picture because it just lets us know the Holy Spirit, who is like a dove, how that he just descends on our lives, that he hovers over our lives, and then he descends upon our lives. And let's remember what Jesus said, what he said in verse 39. When he talked about these living waters, right, that will flow out of us. In verse 39, he said, but this spoke he of the Spirit, whom they that believed on him should receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. And we look at this and we understand that the Holy Spirit hadn't come yet. But praise God that when Jesus died and he rose again, and he ascended back to heaven, that one of the things that he left was the Holy Spirit. And if we think about the Holy Spirit, that I want to deal with this. And here's my message. That I just gave you the introduction, right? So let's get into the message now. Let's get into the meat of the message. And that is, if the Holy Spirit is flowing out of you, you should be manifesting the fruit of the Spirit. If God promised that he was going to send his Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit lives in us, and Jesus said that it would be like living water flowing out of us, then these things should characterize your life. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and self-control. That ought to be your testimony. I mean, either Jesus was saying something that is a reality, or he was just saying something that's impossible to do. But he has given us his Spirit that lets us know that we can do what God has called us to do. Turn to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. And we've read this before, many of us have probably even memorized it. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. But the fruit, oh hallelujah, the fruit or the outflowing of the Holy Spirit, the outflowing of the Holy Spirit. What did Jesus say? Out of you will, when the Spirit comes, out of you what? Will flow rivers. Will flow rivers. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, self-control. Against such there is no law. The first one that he says is love. And the word for love here is agape. So that means that if you have the Holy Spirit, that you have the potential, the ability to exercise agape love. And what is agape love? A loving care that sacrificially gives and endures through any situation. Let me give you an example of agape. And when I give this example, some of you are going to say, yeah, I couldn't have done that. And when you, by nature of the fact that you're going to say that, so I'm giving you a warning ahead of time. By nature of the fact that you said that, that means that you're not allowing the Spirit to flow through you. We all heard about the police officer in Texas who thought she was going to her apartment, but she went into another apartment And when she went in there, she saw this brother in there. And I'm not going to cast verdict. I'm just going to say that she shot him and killed him, right? Shot him and killed him. And then they had her trial. And she was convicted of murder. And after the trial was over, they let people make impact statements, witness statements. And the brother of the man that was shot came up to make a statement. And I know I'm not quoting it exactly, but he said something to the degree of, I love you and I forgive you. And he went on and began to weep and began to say some other things. And then at the end, he asked the judge, could I give her a hug? Right. So my question is, how many of us would have been there? That's agape. That's agape. You know, we can talk about all the love that we got, and we can talk about all the affection that we have and how that we will sacrifice. You know, we can be like the guy that says, ain't no mountain high enough, ain't no river wide enough, ain't no valley low enough to keep me from you, right? I mean, we can have that and proclaim all that kind of love, but my brothers and sisters, where the rubber meets the road is when you have to do something like that young man did. Why? Because that's agape. That's agape. And when we think of the ultimate example of agape, that's Jesus Christ, who people spat on him, people punched him, people kicked him, people talked about him, and yet he still, when he was dying on the cross, he asked the Father to forgive him. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's agape. And so this really challenges us. If we have the Holy Spirit living in us, then we have to do a spirit check right now. And let's be honest. Let's ask ourselves the question, you know, would we be able to do what that young man did? Or how about the people down in the church in South Carolina, where the guy came in to a Bible study on, I believe it was on a Wednesday, but a weekday night. He came in and he killed all those people in Bible study. They were there to study the Word of God. And yet and still, I heard testimony after testimony of people saying, man, I forgive him. I forgive him. I hope he gives his heart to Christ. Man, I mean, this is this stuff that we preach every Sunday, that we have devotions about, that we learn about. This is that stuff in action. And sadly, that many of us are not there. You know, I would be honest with you. I would like to think I was there if something like that happened. I would really like to think I was there. But it all depends how much you are allowing the Holy Spirit to flow out of you. The second thing, if Jesus said out of your belly, I like the word, even though the word is heart, I like that word belly, right? Out of your belly, out of your bowels shall flow rivers of living water. I mean, you know, we sing the song, deep, deep, deep down in my soul, I got the joy of Jesus, and it's deep down in my soul. Man, when you got it deep down in, when the Spirit is residing deep within your heart, that if you get cut, and I'm saying this facetiously now, but if you get cut, you bleed Holy Spirit. Why? Because the Spirit is such an essential part of who you are. Joy was the second thing. And what is joy? A deep and abiding inner happiness that is based on spiritual realities and not on your circumstances. You see, if my joy is based on the fact that my bankroll is fat, if my joy is based upon the fact that I'm driving around in a brand new car, if my joy is built in the fact that I got a house or I got clothes or I got a relationship, if that's where my joy is at, what happens when those things are taken away? Then my joy is gone. Then my joy is gone. If I'm proud in riding down the street, leaning, driving with one finger, diamond in the back, sunroof top, digging the scene with a gangster lean. Woo-hoo. And somebody smashes into my ride, and I don't have my ride anymore. If that's where my joy was at, then my joy is gone. But if I've allowed the Holy Spirit to take control of my life, if I've allowed the Holy Spirit to abide deep down inside of me, the joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it away. That if I'm allowing this joy, see, the problem is, my brothers and sisters, is that sometimes we let people steal our joy. And if it's rooted deep down inside, it shouldn't go anywhere, because we have the Holy Spirit that's living within us. Peace. Now notice, and I didn't even point this out, that the first three are from God, right? And then we'll see that the second three, you know, come within, and then they are exercised without, right? But these come from God. This peace, this irene, a tranquility of heart. Now notice this. It's important that you understand this. Oh, man. It's based on a right relationship with God. If you don't know the Lord, if you've never accepted the Lord, I'm going to tell you something. And I know some of y'all might get mad at me, but I know I'm preaching, right? I'm preaching better than y'all shouting, but that's okay. All right? That if you don't know Christ, then you don't know peace. You really don't. You know, you might think that you have a form of peace, because again, it goes back to, if all my needs are taken care of, if everything is in line, then, you know, I'm happy, right? But if I've got peace, it's not based on my circumstances. Yeah, I had the opportunity to preach the other night on Cornerstone Television, a salvation message, and I shared my testimony, how that before I came to Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, that I would pray every night. And I would pray this prayer, and I'm sure that many of you, you know, have prayed this too. Now I lay me down to sleep, pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. God bless mommy, daddy, people at Disney World, Mickey, Donald, all them people, right? So, I mean, you pray for everybody, right? But after I prayed that prayer, I still didn't know what was going to happen to me if I died. I still didn't know if I closed my eyes in death, what was going to happen to me. And I prayed that prayer every night. Oh, but one day, I met the Savior. And when I came face to face with Jesus, and I accepted him as my Lord and Savior, I'm going to tell you what, man, a peace came over me that I cannot describe. And I know that now, when I lay my head down at night, no matter what else is going on around me, I know to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Is to wake up in his presence, where there's fullness of joy, and at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. You can't get that. You can't buy that from the world. You know, since the history of mankind, do you know there's been very few years where there hasn't been a war somewhere? Oh, I'm telling you something now. That there hasn't been a war somewhere. In Africa, man, you got tribes fighting tribes. In the Middle East, you got Muslims fighting against Muslims. You know, around the world, you got all kind of wars going on. And I think John MacArthur said it was like 214 years in the history of the world where there hasn't been a war, where there's been peace. I'm going to tell you something. You're not going to have peace until the Prince of Peace, first of all, resides in your heart, but then he comes back and takes the throne. And then that's when we will know true peace. And this peace comes through the Holy Spirit. The first three were from God. We see that as we move on to the next slide, this is how we treat others, right? If we've got the Holy Spirit, then this is how we treat others. And it says that we are long suffering. And the word long suffering is the Greek word makathumeo. And what it means is that you have ability to tolerate even when you've been injured. When others have afflicted injury upon you, that you have no desire to seek retaliation. That's what the word means in its essence. But what else can we draw from that? That means that when we've been wronged, that, you know, and let's be honest, if somebody wrongs us, we get hurt. And we might have to go somewhere and lick our wounds and have a pity party. You know, we might have to do that. But after we come out of that, you know, we should come out of that. And I still might not be ready to forgive. I might not be ready to be restored. But in my heart, there has to be something in my heart that says that I got some long suffering. And that even though I've been wounded, that I'm going to get over this and that I'm going to fight back through it. See, the thing is that when somebody wounds us and when somebody offends us, you know, the first thing that we want to do and the first thing that we think about, how can I get back? You know, come on, I know I'm preaching. I've been there. I've been there. You want something bad to happen to the person, right? You really do. Because they hurt, man, don't you know that you hurt me? And I want to see you hurt. And then, you know, sometimes, you know, we don't even want to forgive the other person because we want to get our pound of flesh, right? I mean, we want to make sure that they suffer equally as we have suffered and what we have had to deal with, and so we don't want to let the thing go. Okay. I don't want to make some people mad. But if you got the Holy Spirit, what kind of attitude is that? If the Holy Spirit is living in you, and you are holding grudges and you are holding bitterness from something that happened years ago and you can't let it go, there's something wrong with the Spirit working in your life. And you know, the Bible says that we can grieve the Spirit or we can quench the Spirit. I believe that when we don't have this long suffering and we have a short fuse and a short wick, that we disable the Spirit working in our life. Oh, the Spirit is still there. The Spirit is not going anywhere. But he's not going to be. Taylor, go back to that picture where it showed that waterfall. Yeah. That's what I want. That's what I want. I want the Spirit to flow out of me. And how is the Spirit flowing out of me when I'm long-suffering? If I'm not long-suffering, the Spirit is not flowing out of me. I'm not connected to the Spirit like I should be. Thank you. So we go back. Gentleness. This is how you treat others. This is a kind disposition that manifests itself in a tender concern for others. Man, you know, there are people that are rough. You know, and they treat other people rough, right? Sometimes, man, I'm around the saints, and I hear how they say something to another saint, and I'm like, man, that was kind of rough. You know, that was kind of rough. You know, now people say, well, that's just my personality, right? Well, then you might need to let the Holy Spirit take control of your personality, right? You might need to yield your spirit over to the Holy Spirit. But I just see that there's a roughness and a crudeness in the way that we deal with other people, and there's just no gentleness to it at all. You know, when I have the Spirit in me, that I handle things in a gentle manner. I handle things in a godly manner. Gentleness, goodness, an action that reaches out to others to do good even when they don't deserve it. When we see people that are in need, when we see people that are hurting, when we see those around us suffering, you know, is there goodness in our heart? You know, is our heart pricked? And do we look at, you know, the needs around us? Do we look at the people around us? And does goodness spring forth out of our heart? Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. And then, this is in self. First one, from God. The second one, to others. And then third, to self. Faith. And this is having a quality that renders a person trustworthy. You know, at first, you know, when I was studying this, I said, well, you know, it's talking about that Hebrews 11 faith, right? Where faith is the substance of things hoped for and evidence of the things not seen. But that's, we talk about that faith somewhere else. This faith right here is a quality where people can trust you. You know, that you have that spirit of God in you and that you can be trusted. And then meekness. I love meekness. And that is the heart to hear what God has to say and then respond in consideration to others. And so meekness really is this idea of power under control, right? If I'm a meek person, that means that I got the ability to do something, that I have the power to do something, that I might have the power to go beat somebody up. I might have the power to go and out-talk somebody. I might have the power to do these things. But because of the Holy Spirit, a meekness comes over me. Right? Remember Jesus when he was in the garden and Peter got up and cut off that guy's ear and Jesus said, put up your sword. He said, I could call 24,000 angels down to come and help me right now. That's power under control. And so the meek do not abuse the power that's given to them. And then the last thing is self-control. Self-control. And this is, if I've got the Holy Spirit, and so, you know, I know, you know, in areas that I struggle with, and sometimes it's in the area of self-control. You know, I'll confess. You know, I don't want to be the, I know I'm not the only one, but I'm the only one that'll confess, right? You know, and this is the ability to restrain passions, appetites, and natural impulses. That you know, if we've got the Holy Spirit, now I'm getting ready to preach, but I'm preaching to myself now. So if you happen to get on this sermon that I'm getting ready to preach right now, you know, then praise God. But you know, if you know that you should be If you know you should be eating a certain way, right? And the Holy Spirit is in you. Either one or two things. Either you have given over to the desires of the flesh, or you say, help me, Holy Ghost. Help me, Holy Ghost. And that you truly depend upon the Holy Spirit. And I would have to believe that if you truly depend upon the Holy Spirit, that he will help you to do whatever it is. But a lot of times, you know, we just get in our mind that, you know, we want a certain thing and we want it a certain way. And then we don't put any restraints on that. But do we ever stop and check and ask the Holy Spirit, say, Holy Spirit, I need you to help me. If you live inside of me, out of my belly flows rivers of living water. If that's the case, then you can help me, Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit, if we are sincere, I have to believe that he will help us. You know, I think that there are some things that the Holy Spirit helps us with that we don't even realize he's helping us. And we've got the victory over some things that we don't even realize we got the victory. The Holy Spirit is just doing his job. But then there's other things that I believe that some of us will struggle until the day that they throw dirt in our face. And we have to ask God to help us through the power of the Holy Spirit. As I conclude the message today, this is what's called an emotions chart, right? And you can look at the different faces and you can see what that face represents. And the face actually represents something that is where? In the heart, right? So, I mean, if you even can't read those words, right? If you even can't read those words up there, you can look at each face and kind of tell what that face represents because it's coming out of the heart. But praise God, on the other side, if we have the Holy Spirit, as Jesus said, then out of our life shall flow the things of the Holy Spirit. So I ask you the question, what's flowing out of you? You're on your way here today. What was flowing out of you? Yesterday, just think back yesterday and what was in your life. You know, and even put those faces back up there. You know, put those faces back up there. You know, even if one of these faces, you know, was represented, was a representation of your heart. Is that the same as the Spirit flowing out of your life? God challenged, I know God is dealing with my heart, man. I'll just be honest with you. I know that I'm not as yielded to the Holy Spirit all the time as I would like to be. And I just pray, man, that the Lord would help me depend on the Holy Spirit that's within me. So that whatever I'm struggling with, that I'm going to make it through with the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, Jesus said that he was leaving, that he was going away, but that he was going to send another comforter, and that comforter would represent him. And whereas Jesus walked outside with the disciples outwardly, the Holy Spirit would come and live within us. What a powerful, powerful exchange. Father, we come to you today. And Lord, we thank you for the Holy Spirit. Lord, and as the song was sung earlier, Lord, about praying to the Holy Spirit. And Lord, just praying for the Holy Spirit to come into our lives and guide us and direct us. And we know that the Spirit is already there, but we want to experience the Holy Spirit in greater ways, that we want to experience the Holy Spirit in deeper ways. And so, Lord, I ask that you would allow all of us, Lord, to make that connection where that Spirit is just flowing out of us, and we have the victory in this life that you have called us to live. Father, I pray today that if there's someone here that has never accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and this is the time that you want them to come to find out more about Jesus and how to accept him and how to make him the Lord of their life, as we give the invitation, Lord, I pray that they would come. Father, I pray that if there's someone today looking for a place to fellowship, looking for a church home, and this is where you would have them to be, Lord, we ask that they would come as we give the invitation right now. And we commit it to you, Lord. Ask you to have your way. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let us stand.